Are you concerned about overpopulation? It certainly is a controversial topic. With over 7 billion humans on the planet, some people worry about whether there are enough resources to meet everyone's needs. Did you know that since the agricultural revolution, 8,000 years ago, until the industrial revolution, which began in 1750, that the world's population grew by only 67,000 people every year? Now we gain that many people every 6 to 7 hours. Thank you, Paul Ehrlich, for that huge wake-up call. With fertility rates so much higher than mortality rates, particularly in less industrialized countries, we are experiencing exponential growth, and it isn't expected to level off until we hit 9 to 10 billion people in 2050. There are different ways to deal with this, and not everybody agrees with each other. One way depends on what is called the demographic transition theory, which tells the history of how mortality and fertility rates have dropped with industrialization. Let's start by talking about mortality, also known as death rates, and fertility, or birth rates. For most of human history, we were in stage one. See how the mortality and fertility rates were really high? Because of things like the plague, famine, war, and poor living conditions, people died pretty young. To make up for all those people dying, they had to have a lot of babies. Of course, there were other reasons too. I'm sure you can imagine a few. First, we need to recognize that children were defined as assets. They were workers, of course, usually helping their families with different tasks. A woman's status was also defined by how many children she had, especially if they were boys. And these women and children were seen as property and therefore represented the wealth of men. They also would want to make sure that enough children would live long enough to take care of them when they were old. Throw in religious and cultural norms, and you can see why the fertility rates were so high. Then something shifted. You can see that beginning in 1750, with the start of the Industrial Revolution, that mortality rates began to drop. The early industrial era of stage two is marked by improvements in sanitation and healthcare. But notice that the fertility rates stay high. This is known as a cultural lag, because the technology that improved mortality rates changed faster than the culture's ability to adapt. Think about it. How long would it take to simply have faith that your babies would live, so you didn't have to have so many? One? Maybe two generations? What about the time it would take to change gender roles or religious norms? Well, that's a long time. And over that time, look what's happening to the population level. Just do the math. If fertility rates stay high and mortality rates are low, then the population booms. Note that by stage three, as industrialization continues, the fertility rates eventually start to drop. One of the biggest reasons for this is that children are redefined from assets to liabilities. While most people still want to have children, they choose to have far fewer than in the past. Beyond decreasing child mortality and changing elder care, girls are going to school, women are working, and most industrialized countries have child labor laws. So, bottom line, women are postponing having children. Plus, kids are expensive. So fertility rates in industrialized countries continue to drop and are now close to, if not below, replacement rates. Thus, by stage four in post-industrialized countries, mortality and fertility rates are both low and population growth finally stabilizes again. This looks pretty good, right? Well, there are some caveats. First, there's a big risk. What about this stage in the middle, where the fertility rates are so much higher than mortality rates? With all of this population growth, Lester Brown warns us about the risk of the demographic trap. Instead of transitioning into stage three and four, a region can get overwhelmed by people and go beyond its carrying capacity. In that case, food and water and other necessities will run out. In fact, things could get so bad that they will consume all of their resources, and Mother Nature and human conflict will push them back into stage one. It's not a pretty picture, and Mother Nature can be very harsh. We're already seeing this happening in different regions around the world, such as in Somalia, where environmental problems are becoming the number one cause of refugees. But that's not the only risk. While some policy analysts, who are often called anti-Malthusians, believe that the answer to overpopulation is industrialization and economic development, because that is what has worked in the past. Others warn that there simply aren't enough resources on the planet to enable countries all around the world to industrialize in the manner of the past. These Neo-Malthusians, who base their assumptions on the teachings of Thomas Malthus, critique the demographic transition theory because they claim that the consumption rates of the industrialized world face very real limits on a finite planet. While we certainly have solved a lot of problems with science, technology, and economic development, and it is argued that there currently is enough food on the planet, if we had proper distribution, it is still unclear if industrialization is the answer to overpopulation, given our consumption rates. And of course, it never goes over well if one country tells another that they should have fewer babies. So, the reality is that population rates are complex and therefore require complex solutions. From technological breakthroughs and changes in gender roles to environmental concerns and ethnic and class issues, it is a challenge to find a balance between individual rights and community and planetary needs. We have certainly learned a lot from the demographic transition theory in the past, but it is unclear which direction the future will lead.